Hey, good morning. Good morning to Zarephath Christian Church. We welcome you out there. We welcome you to stand up and praise the Lord. He is worthy of praise. I'll tell you, I am looking forward to this July 12 event. I'm looking forward to being together as a body, but so much more than that, so much more than that. We can look forward to the presence of Jesus Christ, and He promises to be here this morning with you. So, Lord, we love You. Thank You for being with us. Thank You that we can kneel at Your feet and be with You and glorify You and lift up Your name. You are worthy to be praised. You have shown such mercy to us, shown such love to us, that we are so thankful to just be able to take a moment and sit and say, Lord, we love You. In Your name we pray.
With me. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. Take a moment. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. There you go, there you go, there you go, lifting my load again. No longer am I held by. No longer am I held by the yoke of this world. Come up under the yoke of Jesus. Yoke is easy, His burden is so light. No longer am I held by the yoke of this world. Come up under the yoke of Jesus. Yoke is easy, His burden is so light. Burden is so light.
Take a moment.
Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, my Lord again. There you go, there you go, there you go, lifting my Lord again.
Lord, would You come lift our load? Will we lay it before You?
You're lifting my load, You're lifting my load, You're lifting my load, Lord. are faithful. So your love carries. Cause your love carries. Your love carries me through all the valleys and the darkest places. Your love carries. Your love carries me through all the valleys and the darkest places. Your love carries. Your love carries me through all the valleys and the darkest places. I thank you that your love, well, it does extend, Lord, into our darkest places. Lord, when fear overtakes us and stress feels too much to bear, Lord, help us to rest in you. Help me to rest in you. Lord, help me to rest in you. Lord, you're the only one with the wisdom to heal, the only one with the power to redeem. Lord, thank you that you've made yourself known to us. Lord, we look to you and we praise you.
Father God, only by the blood are we set free. You alone hold a power to redeem. Father, your abounding grace is so great. The grace of you, O God, sometimes is overwhelming. In the book of Romans, chapter 5, verse 20 through 21, it reads, "For where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. That as sin hath reigned until death, even so my grace reigned through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. We rejoice, friends. We rejoice as we are set free. Father God, help us and free us from all that we need to lay down, Father. All of our sins, Father, any depression, any angst, feeling of rejection, Lord, anxiety, depression, addiction, Father, you are the only one that can set us free. Father God, we are so grateful that we can come before you, that we can worship you, that we can bow before your throne, Father, and praise you, and prayer is right here for you, Father, and you receive our prayer. We love you and we praise you in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Well, hello, Zarephath family. So great to be back with you. My name is Christina Mosley. On behalf of the host team, welcome to our ZCC online service. I haven't been here for a while, and it's so nice to be back. If you're new here, please do go to our website at www.zarephath.org. You're going to scroll down, and there's a link, a box that you can click that says Connect and Prayer. We'd love to get to know you, answer any questions, and also it's a great place for all of us, our church family, to put in prayer requests and praise reports. So please do that. And now, children, this is a time for you. So let's see what Miss Megan has in store this week.
Good morning, boys and girls. Welcome to Kids Church. We are starting a new series called We Are Family. We're going to learn about God's plan for our families by studying families in the Bible. Moms and dads, a new month and a new series means new Bible memory verses. So be sure to follow us on Instagram for our updates on activity ideas and our memory verses. Boys and girls, each one of our families are different, and we're going to see that families in the Bible were different from each other too. What makes your family unique or special? Maybe you're the only boy or the only girl in your family. Maybe you're adopted or live with a foster family. Maybe you live with your grandma or your aunt and uncle. Maybe you're the only kid in your family and you have your mom and dad all to yourself. Or maybe you have lots of brothers and sisters and you never have to look for anybody to play with. Every single family is different, but we all have something in common. God put each of our families together. He designed them especially for us. He cares for each one of our families, and today we're going to hear a story from the Bible about a family who learned to trust Him. This Bible story comes from the book of Genesis, and it's from chapters 17, 18, and 21. At last, Abraham and Sarah reached the land of Canaan, and God said, "Look all around you. I'm giving everything you can see to you, to your children, and to your children's children forever. Your family will be like the dust of the ground, too many to count." What an amazing promise. But there was a problem. Abraham and Sarah didn't have any children. Not one. And they were old, really old. God was promising them the impossible. Still, Abraham trusted God to do what he said he was going to do. Years passed and there was still no baby. So one night, God led Abraham outside and reminded him of his promise. "Do you see all those stars?" God asked. "One day, your family will be like those stars. You won't be able to count them all." Abraham believed God would keep all his promises. He had faith. Still more years passed, and God came to Abraham once again to remind him of his promise. "I will make you the father of many nations." God promised Abraham and Sarah a son, which made Sarah laugh. After all, she was 90 years old, and Abraham was 99. How could she have a baby now? It was impossible. But just a year later, Sarah was laughing again. This time, she laughed with joy as she and Abraham held their baby son, Isaac. God had kept his promise. But just a year later, Sarah was laughing again. This time, she laughed with joy as she and Abraham held their baby son, Isaac. God had kept his promise, because God always does what he says he will do. God made a promise to Abraham and Sarah that didn't make any sense. Most grandparents don't have babies. Abraham and Sarah had to trust God with their family. Abraham and Sarah's baby, Isaac, was the answer to God's promise. And God always keeps his promises. Nothing is impossible for him. In this story, God promised to send Isaac, and he did. God also promised in the Bible to send a Savior, and he did. Many, 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 many years later, God sent Jesus, and he was born from Abraham and Isaac's family. How's that for making your family special? We can always trust that God has a purpose for our family. Even when our family goes through difficult times, and all families will, and we don't understand why things happen the way they do, God will help us and lead us if we trust him. Abraham and Sarah were surprised that God kept his promise. They learned to trust that God would follow through every time he made a promise. And the same is true for us today. God always, always, always keeps his promises, and we can trust him with our families. I love you, boys and girls. I'll see you next week. Can you say bye, Shep? Say bye.
Boys and girls, isn't God's word so incredible? We can trust him with our families. And may you have a beautiful time with your family this week making memories. We so appreciate you, Miss Megan. Thank you so much. Church family, I have a great announcement for you this week, and I think you have already gotten wind of it, that we are going to have a great outdoor event. That's going to happen this coming Sunday. It's July 12th at 10 a.m. It's our United Together Outdoor Worship event. You can register online. Please do go to our homepage and register. Once you register, maybe you have some questions about the event. There's some more details there that you can gather right there on the website. So please do register. I'm so excited about this event. I do miss seeing everyone. I'm really looking forward to it, so I'll be there too. And now it's a time for us to continue our worship through our givings of our tithes and offerings. Would you please pray with me? Eternal Father, thank you, Lord, so much for all that we have. Father God, thank you for who you are. Thank you for our church, for our families, for our leadership, Father. We just are so grateful for you. And most importantly, Lord, thank you so much for Jesus. Thank you so much for your word. Father God, all that we have belongs to you. Every single gift that we receive. Lord God, help us. Help us as a church family, as well as our personal, in our own personal families, to steward our money well. Steward all our resources, everything that we have, all that we can give, so that we can help impact our local communities and further out through other communities and across our nation and world. Lord God, we love you. May we hold on to the end of your garment, Lord, as we ride this wild ride of life. We trust you and we lift you most high. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Sing of his promises evermore. And pour out your thankfulness and let it overflow. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let me out of the desert. Brought me into his streams, a river of living water. is sweet and all my burdens are lifted. You took the shackles off my feet and there's no sound louder than a captive set free. So let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Sing of his promises evermore. Pour out your thankfulness and let it overflow. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Up in my soul, and there's life worth living. Yes, because he calls me his own, and there's a hallelujah after sweet victory, and there's no sound louder than a captive set free. Oh, there's no sound louder than a captive set free. So let the
morning, everybody, and happy 4th of July weekend. I'm going to get it right for this holiday as opposed to Father's Day. The Lord made it easy on me because it's the only date, the only holiday that's associated with an actual date. So I know July 5th is the day after 4th of July. So I thought Mother's Day was the second Sunday in May, so Father's Day was the second Sunday in June, but Pastor Chris covered for me, and Chris took care of it for me, and happy 4th of July. And I can't think of a 4th of July that our nation was in need of prayer so much as this one. We seem to be splintering and fracturing and siloing all over the place into different encampments of division. And the enemy divides. That's what Satan wants to do. He wants to scatter. He wants to divide. And in the past, in times of crisis, we've come together as a nation, and it just seems that with this crisis, we're splitting further apart. And you add to the crisis of COVID, there's the reemergence of the ugliness of racism, and so many other issues that it's time that we really need to get on our faces and pray. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. We're redeemed. We're free. We're people who really know what freedom is about, the freedom that is in Christ. And our country needs to know that freedom. So I want to pray for our nation, and then I'm going to pray for the word. Heavenly Father, we come before you on behalf of the United States of America. You have said that we should pray for our rulers and those who are in authority. We should seek the peace of the place where you have put us, and that's what we do. We pray for peace for America. We pray that you would bring us together. We pray that what is dividing us will get turned around, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, you will come in there and begin to unite us again and cause us to rally together as one nation, e pluribus unum, in many one, that we would know the meaning behind that again as a country. We pray for the spread of the gospel across our country. We know that the gospel, redemption, people being set free by the power of the blood of Jesus Christ, that is what the United States of America needs more than anything else. And we pray for revival in our land. We pray for revival in New Jersey, at Zarephath, in this church, and in the churches in our region, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will come on this dry ground and flood it, and that you'll use this word today to speak to many hearts. I pray this word will bring revival. I pray this word will stir up by the Holy Spirit within the hearts of your people an excitement and a urgency to move forward in you with their eyes fixed above. Be glorified in this word, I pray this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want to tell you about a woman named Mary. She was 18 years old in 1980 and on the assembly line at a GM plant in Detroit. This job was simply a temporary summer job. Mary was going to save some money for college, and her job was to inspect the fenders and hoods of Pontiac Grand Prix as they came off the assembly line. But Mary was distressed by what she saw. As these vehicles came off the assembly line, she just saw again and again many imperfections in the fenders and in the hoods. And it distressed her because her dad, Ray, had just retired after 39 years as a die maker for General Motors at that very same plant. And Mary knew her dad. He was a bit of a perfectionist. He loved things to be done well, to be done right. He was a tinkerer. He loved to take things apart and put them back together again, even better than they ever were before. In fact, when Mary was a little girl and she finished all her chores, her reward was that her mother allowed her to go in the basement where her dad had a workshop, and he would be working on some gadget or thing that he had taken apart to put back together again. And Mary just loved that. And then a thought came to her that summer. Maybe, just maybe, I can do more than just inspect the imperfections in these fenders and hoods. Maybe I can do something about it. And Mary had a change in mindset and a change in plans. And she decided that she was going to enroll in General Motors School of Engineering. And she did that, and her professors were impressed by her thirst for knowledge and how quickly she picked up on things and her intuition and her zeal and her work ethic. And Mary started to do other jobs at General Motors, now as a low-level engineer, and she began advancing to the point that 8 years later, just at the age of 26, General Motors sent Mary to Stanford University's MBA program. They paid for the whole bill. They saw something special in her. In 2003, Mary was put in charge of her own plant. She was responsible for 3,400 employees, and she excelled at it. 10 years later, in 2013, the board of directors of General Motors voted unanimously that Mary Barra would be their new chief executive officer. She runs the company to this day. Mary clearly, from 18 years old, inspecting fenders and hoods, was on a fast track. Not just the fast track outside where she liked to test drive the cars, but a literal fast track in that company right to the top. And it begs a question. Do you think God has a fast track? Do you think in the kingdom of God, God wants to see us get to a place where we are so utilized and used by Him, where we are just accelerating and growing and the responsibilities are increasing ever, ever more? And I say the answer to that is yes, and we can see it clearly in the person we look at this morning. Acts chapter 6, verse 1. Now at this time, the disciples were increasing in number, and a complaint arose on the part of the Hellenistic Jews against the native Hebrews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily serving of food. Whenever you have any operation that involves people, you will have issues. You will have problems. There will be complaints. The church where I pastored for 20 years, we saw some significant growth. But along with that growth came significant increase in complaints and problems and issues and fires to be put out. My administrative assistant and I, whenever we were overwhelmed by these things, we had a scripture verse we would quote to one another. Take a look at it. Proverbs 14, verse 4. Where no oxen are, the manger is clean, but much increase comes by the strength of the ox. What does that mean? Well, oxen in the barn, they make a mess, if you know what I mean. And it's a mess that's got to be cleaned up. And if there are no oxen in the barn, there are no messes to clean up. But guess what? If you don't have any oxen, you don't have a harvest. And it's all about the harvest. And in church, if you don't have people, you don't have a harvest. And it's all about the people. But inevitably, people bring with them issues. I love the story about the man who was stranded on a desert island for many years. And they finally tracked him down and they arrived on the island and they were in awe of his industriousness and how he had utilized different things on the island to survive. And he had built three structures. And they asked him, what's this structure over here? And he proudly said, oh, that's my home. That's where I lived. They pointed to the second one and he said, oh, that's my church. That's where I worship the Lord. They pointed to the third one and he sadly said, oh, that's the church where I used to go. That's how it is. You have church, you've got issues. Zarephath has issues. My church had issues. They all had issues. You know why? They had people in them. The issues aren't the problems necessarily. The problem, real problem arises when you don't navigate through them well. And they just become bigger and bigger and bigger. And we're going to see in the infant church at the very beginning, they had this big issue, and yet they navigated through it amazingly well. What was the issue? Well, the Hellenistic widows seem, we don't know for sure if this is accurate, but there was a complaint. They seem to have been neglected in the daily distribution of food, whereas the native Hebrew widows were being taken care of. What's all that about? I need to give you a little context. Jews today even have this huge debate over who's really a Jew. The Orthodox, rigid Jews who abide by the law, the strictest interpretations of the law, they would actually say that many of those who claim to be Jews aren't really Jews because they're not following the law. And back in the first century, there was this debate as well because Jews had scattered all over the world. And many of them who had gone to other cities, learned Greek, adopted the customs of those cities, adopted the habits of those cities, and they were looked at by the native Hebrews of Jerusalem as being unfaithful to their faith. When I was in Israel on one of my trips, I got to visit an archaeological dig in Caesarea. Archaeologists had unearthed a synagogue from this time period. And they unearthed a mosaic floor that was just spectacular. It was so beautiful. And on this mosaic floor were depictions of various images. And over here, you saw the menorah, and you saw shovels and pans like are described as being used in the temple, and you saw other furnishings depicted on the floor from the temple. But on this side of the floor were the 12 signs of the zodiac on the same floor in a synagogue. These were Hellenistic Jews. They combined them both. And so in Jerusalem, we have on the day of Pentecost, a gathering in of all the Jews from around the world, both Orthodox and these somewhat secular Jews, all coming for the Feast of Pentecost. Peter preaches, 3,000 come into the church. Later, another 5,000 will come into the church. And you've got all these Hellenistic Jews mingling with the native Hebrew Jews. Add to this the fact that it was believed that you wanted to die in Jerusalem because they thought that the resurrection would start on the Mount of Olives. And so you want to die in Jerusalem, be buried on the Mount of Olives, because you will be the first one to come out of the grave in the resurrection. Now, that's not supported by Scripture, but it's what they believed. And so what happened is, as Jews all over the world got old and near the time to die, they moved to Jerusalem. It's inevitable that men die first. And because the husbands died first, they were survived by their widows. Put it all together, and you've got Hellenistic widows, and you've got native Hebrew widows, and they need to be taken care of. There's no Social Security, there's no Medicare, there's no Medicaid, there's no nursing homes, there's no assisted facilities, assisted living facilities. The synagogue took care of its elderly, and they were mostly widows. And the Hellenistic widows, apparently, were being neglected, and this complaint arose. What were they going to do about it? How were they going to take care of it? Take a look. Verse 2. And the 12 summoned the congregation of the disciples and said, "It's not desirable for us to neglect the word of God in order to serve tables, but select from among you, brethren, 7 men of good reputation, full of the spirit and of wisdom, whom we may put in charge of this task. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and the ministry of the word." And the statement found approval with the whole congregation, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte from Antioch. And these they brought before the apostles, and after praying, they laid their hands on them. First of all, I want you to notice what the apostles did. When we get problems, when we get issues that have to be addressed, we drop everything and address them. Now, that's not necessarily bad, but when they begin to pile up and we address this one and then this one and that one, do you know the first thing that gets neglected in your spiritual life? Your time of prayer and the Word. When I was a brand new Christian, I was just devouring Scripture. I couldn't wait to pray. I was 18 years old. I lived in the basement of my house in Whitestone, Queens, and our home would flood on occasion. And in the springtime, especially when there was a lot of rain, and in the basement, there would be like an inch or two of water. And one of my jobs and one of my chores was whenever it flooded, I was to get the shop vac out, the wet dry vac, and take care of the flood. Well, I'm at work all day and it's pouring rain. And I come home and there's a flood in my basement, but I didn't get up early enough that day to have my time in the Word. So I get my chair, I lift my feet above the flood, I put it on another chair, and I sit there, and I'm reading the Word and praying, and my mom comes downstairs. She knows my job is to clean the flood. And she's like, "Kevin, don't you see there's a flood?" And I said, "Mom, I'll take care of it. But first I have to read the Word and talk to the Lord." And she didn't quite know what to make of that at the time. She came to understand over time. Don't neglect the Word. Even if there's a flood going on, make sure you have your time, because that's the first thing to go out the door, and it's the thing you need most of all, to talk to God, to order your day before Him, to read Scripture. The apostles were not going to let that happen. And here's a little clue, and it became real to me in the last 2 weeks again. Use the Word in prayer. In other words, don't make them two separate things necessarily. As you read the Word, turn the Word into prayer. And here's what I mean. I was praying about 2 weeks ago about a number of issues. I was praying about Zarephath. I was praying for Zarephath. I was praying for your search for a pastor. I was praying that God would bring you the right man in the right time and the right person, could be a woman too, that God would bring the one He's anointed to lead you quickly, soon. You need it. And I was praying for a whole list of other things. And as I was doing it, then I had my time in the Word, and wow, God gave me the perfect prayer in the Word. Here it is. Look at it. And you should write this down. You should commit this to prayer. 2 Chronicles 14:11. "Lord, there is no one besides Thee to help in the battle between the powerful and those who have no strength. So help us, O Lord our God, for we trust in thee. And in thy name we have come against this multitude, O Lord. Thou art our God. Let not man prevail against thee. I started praying that. I've been praying that almost every day. I've got to get it perfectly to memory. I don't yet, but I say to the Lord, and I have my prayers in mind, I say, Lord, there is no one besides thee to help in the battle between the powerful and those who have no strength. So help me, Lord, my God. For I trust in you, and I have come out against the multitude of these things in your name. So don't let man prevail. And pick, listen, did you hear this last part? Don't let man prevail against you. What happens in that prayer? It stops being things that are against me, and I turn it over to God so that now these things are against him. He's on the front lines. He's leading the battle against these things. It's a freeing thing. Pray that scripture. Bring it to the Lord. So what do? They decide they're not neglecting the word. They're not neglecting prayer. Pick from among you seven men, good reputation, full of the Spirit and wisdom. Did you see the list of men that they picked? They all have Greek names. There isn't a native Hebrew among them. They have names like Nicanor and Parmenas and Prochorus, and they're all Greek names. And here's wisdom. When there's a complaint, put the person complaining in charge of solving it. It takes care of a lot of things. So there was a complaint from the Hellenistic Jews. Their widows were being neglected. So who did they put in charge of this? Hellenistic Jews. You guys take care of it. That was so wise. Two of them, Stephen and Philip, their stories, and we're going to do Stephen today, their stories take up 10% of the book of Acts. Two of these deacons that we would never know about unless there was an issue. Now, here's an interesting principle in the kingdom of God. Problems will come your way because they're supposed to. You will experience opposition, trials, and difficulties because you're supposed to. Do you know why? Those are opportunities for you to grow in the Lord. We would have never known about Philip. We would never have known about Stephen if there was not this issue. Embrace the issues and simply say to the Lord, Lord, what am I supposed to learn from this challenge? What is it you're trying to do in me and through me in this difficulty I am facing right now? Because they will come because they're supposed to come, because that's how we grow. And so because this issue came, they picked these men, and what were the characteristics? Here's what's fascinating. In Acts chapter 1, they need a replacement for Judas Iscariot because he had hung himself. They need somebody to be one of the 12 apostles. That's a pretty big job. What was the job description? It has to be someone who's been with us since the time of John the Baptist's baptism, right up until the moment Jesus went to heaven. Let's see, who is that? Okay, there's Matthias and Barsabbas. There's two of them. We have one spot. Let's draw lots. That's how they picked that important position. Here we are now after the day of Pentecost, which happens in Acts chapter 2, and they are rocked by the power of the Holy Spirit, and they have a whole different mindset. And so when it comes to who's going to serve tables, they have to be people of a good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit, and full of wisdom. Wisdom. I can't emphasize enough. I have a whole other sermon, maybe one day I'll preach it here, about the critical importance of wisdom. If I held up to you a glass of water that was filled halfway, the pessimist would say, that is a glass half empty. The optimist would say, that is a glass half full. The wise person would say, who's thirsty? Knowledge knows what things are. Wisdom knows why things are. And you can only know why things are when you know the one who made them and put in them the purpose for their implementation. Knowledge can be gained by books. Knowledge can be gained by degrees and years in school, but there's no PhD in wisdom. There's no Wisdom Institute of Technology. You can only get wisdom from one place, and that is the source of wisdom itself, God. And this brings me to another prayer you can pray every day. This promise in James. James chapter 1, verse 5. But if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all men generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. Ask God for it. Ask God every day, Lord, make me wise. Ask for it diligently. I promise you this. I'm going to say in a month, you'll begin to say things. You'll say, who said that? I said that. You'll get wisdom. God will give it to you because he said he would in his word. Now, why did they have to be men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom? To serve tables. Yes, to serve tables. A menial task? Absolutely not. We have a problem. I have it. You have it. We all have it. We're born with what I call a twisted grid. Here's what I mean. Input comes to us. Information, situations, words, circumstances. They come into our sensory gates of our eyes and our ears, our olfactory system. We taste, just we have input systems. It's that all of that data is then compiled in our brain, and we have a perspective on this input. But that perspective is twisted by our grid. Our grid is the filter that this input hits before it gets processed within us. The grid is comprised of how you were raised, your background, your self-esteem, what you were told you were as a child or by others, what you believe you are or are not in your own mind, your perception of an inadequacy for whatever reason. All these things twist our grid so that when the input comes, it hits this twisted grid and gets processed incorrectly. And one of the ways things get processed incorrectly is how we value tasks. Tasks are valued based on what they are. The grid gets twisted to believe that you do what you do in an important way based on what you do. And if you wait on tables, that's not really important. But God has a perfect grid. The grid of God's lines are righteousness, justice, holiness, perfection. God's grid is perfect. And when you're redeemed, your grid begins to get straightened out and you begin to see things differently. Let me give you an example. I had a job when I was going through seminary. I had a job I worked at that I was trying to save money so I could pay my tuition. I hated it. I hated going to work every day. I hated going to bed at night because I knew I'd have to wake up in the morning and go to that job. And all day long, I couldn't wait for the day to end. Did you ever have a job like that? I had a job like that. Until one day, everything changed. And the day it changed was when I got God's grid, not my grid. Here's God's grid. Colossians chapter 3, verse 23 and 24. Colossians 3, 23 and 24. Whatever you do, do your work heartily as for the Lord rather than for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance. It is the Lord Christ whom you serve. I died to myself when I gave my life to Jesus. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and delivered himself up for me. I'm a bond slave. I'm a bond slave of Jesus. I work for Jesus. He's my employer. He's my boss. I'm at this job because he led me to this job. I'm working for him. It set me free. I was happy to go to work. I was happy. And when the issues came down that I was struggling with, it didn't matter because I knew behind them was the Lord, who had appointed me to that place. My grid got straightened out. Isaiah 55, verse 8. Here's God speaking. My thoughts are not your thoughts. Neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. So what about serving tables? It's not about what you do, be it running General Motors or waiting on tables. It's about who you do it for. And when every task is done, no matter what it is, for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, all of those tasks are elevated to an equal plane of awesomeness because you're doing it for Him. That's why these men had to have these qualifications. That's why you and I, when we do whatever we do, Jesus said, you give a cup of cold water to a prophet, you'll receive a prophet's reward. Whatever we do, when we do it for Jesus, we are inadequate in ourselves. We need to get on our face and say, oh God, help me to do a good job for you. Do you know the Lord loves? He loves a good tool. My dad had a saying. He was a carpenter. His saying was, Kevin, the right tool for the right job. I had bought a shop vac a while ago, a different shop vac a while ago. Hadn't had a chance to really use it until last week. I was cleaning out my garage and I wanted to clean the floor. And so I'm vacuuming the floor and I had no idea how great this vacuum was. I loved this vacuum. I was in that garage for a really long time. I was vacuuming everything. I was changing the attachments. I was putting this nozzle on and that hose on. And before you know it, and this is the truth, I was vacuuming the ceiling. I've never vacuumed the ceiling in my life. But I noticed there were gnats up there, bugs that had gotten stuck to the ceiling. And I've got the extended wand on my vacuum. And I'm going, and I'm going back and forth. And inside I said to myself, I'm vacuuming the ceiling. Do you know why? I loved my tool. God loves a good tool. He loves a tool that is surrendered to Him to carry out whatever task He wants. And take a look at this tool named Stephen. Acts chapter 6, verse 7. And the word of God kept spreading, and the number of disciples continued to increase greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were becoming obedient to the faith. That's pretty amazing. A lot of the priests were becoming obedient to the faith. And Stephen, full of grace and power, was performing great wonders and signs among the people. But some men from what was called the synagogue of the freedmen, these are Hellenistic Jews, by the way, the synagogue of the freedmen, including both Cyrenians and Alexandrians and some from Cilicia and Asia, they rose up and argued with Stephen, and yet they were unable to cope with the wisdom and the spirit with which he was speaking. And then they secretly induced men to say, oh, we heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. And they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes, and they came upon him and dragged him away and brought him before the council. This is the Sanhedrin. And they put forward false witnesses who said, this man incessantly speaks against this holy place and the law. For we have heard him say that the Nazarene, remember what I said about the Nazarene a few weeks ago? You'll have to go back and listen. For we have heard him say that this Nazarene, Jesus, will destroy this place and alter the customs which Moses handed down to us. And fixing their gaze on him, all who were sitting in the council saw his face like the face of an angel. Stephen goes from serving tables to signs and wonders. Just make yourself available. Just step out of your boat, start walking on the water toward Jesus with your eyes on him, and you will see signs and wonders. God will begin to use you in amazing ways. He's just waiting for that opportunity. Give him an inch. Just sign up for something. Just do something for him. And all of a sudden, he'll start moving through you in power. He starts preaching. He starts proclaiming. They can't handle Stephen. This is a fulfillment of Jesus' promise. Luke 21, verse 15, Jesus said, I'll give you utterance and wisdom which none of your opponents will be able to resist or refute. And the Greek here, I think it's verse 8, says they were unable to cope. The Greek here, antihistamai. Sounds like antihistamine, I know. But it literally means that histamai is standing. And ante is like anti, you're not able to. Literally, not able to cope means they couldn't stand up against it. In our vernacular, Stephen's wisdom blew them over, knocked them down, blew them away. See, that's what wisdom will do. He was facing opposition. They were dragging him to the Sanhedrin. These people, these priests, this Sanhedrin, their docket has been full of nothing but Christianity. They dealt with Jesus. Shortly after that, they dealt with Peter and John, as you heard from Colin last week. They dealt with Peter and John twice. Now they've got Stephen over the same issues. You would think something would occur to them after a while, like maybe we should look into this Christianity thing. Maybe there's something to it. But Stephen is dragged before them. He's facing incredible opposition. This is going to happen to you. You step out to be used by God and you will be opposed. You will face hard things. You will face trials. But remember, the book of Acts is all about the unhindered gospel. And opposition is not there to hinder you. Opposition is there to unshackle you. Opposition is there to unhinder you. Why? Because opposition is really opportunity for God to do even greater things. And even though there is a storm swirling around Stephen, there is no storm within Stephen. Greater is he who is in Stephen than he who is in the world. Because while their faces are gnarled with sinister hatred, twisted in anger toward Stephen, Stephen has this angelic expression on his face. He's right where God wants him to be. You could be in a completely blissful, peaceful, wonderful existence and not be where God wants you and have this horrible storm swirling inside you. Or you could be surrounded by a storm and have perfect peace because you're right where God wants you. Stephen had been accused by them of speaking words against the law, against Moses and the temple. My text today is about 90 verses. Don't worry, we won't be here until next Father's Day. I'll just summarize chapter 7. Chapter 7 is simply this. It's Stephen disproving their accusation. I am not speaking against the law. I am not speaking against Moses. I'm not speaking against the temple. And he goes on to articulate beautifully a history of Israel having to do with Moses, the law, and the temple to show them that his belief is purely orthodox. They have nothing against him in that regard, but it's his conclusion that they have a difficult time with. Look at chapter 7, the book of Acts, verse 51 and following. Stephen speaking now to the Sanhedrin. You men who are stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears and always resisting the Holy Spirit, you are doing just as your fathers did. Which one of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who had previously announced the coming of the righteous one, whose betrayers and murderers you have now become. You who received the law as ordained by angels and yet did not keep it, they were the ones not keeping the law. They were murderers. Wow. He's speaking the truth. It's a tough truth that he's saying. He's not doing it to condemn them. God speaks some hard truth to you. He does it because he loves you. Stephen did it because he loved these people and he loved the nation of Israel. And he wanted them to understand what had happened so that they would repent. But they don't repent. Verse 54, but when they heard this, they were cut to the quick and they were gnashing their teeth at him. But being full of the Holy Spirit, he gazed intently into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And he said, behold, I see the heavens opened. I see the heavens opened up and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. But they cried out with a loud voice and covered their ears. They couldn't stand hearing this. You know why they couldn't stand hearing this? Because these were the very people, because the Sanhedrin was composed also of the high priest. And Jesus said to the high priest in Mark chapter 14, verse 62, you shall see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power of God. Jesus told them, that's where I'm going, and you're going to see it. And here is Stephen saying it. I see him there, standing at the right hand of the power of God. and they covered their ears. Because if this was true, then they did kill the Messiah. Why not just admit that's what happened? And by the way, Jews did not kill Jesus. Romans did not kill Jesus. We all killed Jesus. We're all responsible because he died for our sins. That's why he went to the cross. But if they would just open their ears to hear, they would repent, realize he is the Messiah, and receive him into their hearts. But instead, they cover their ears. They rush upon him with one accord. And when they had driven him out of the city, they began stoning him. And the witnesses laid aside their robes at the feet of a young man named Saul. And they went on stoning Stephen as he called upon the Lord and said, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And falling on his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And having said this, he fell asleep. And Saul, chapter 8, verse 1, and Saul was in hearty agreement with putting him to death. Back in the early 80s, when AIDS was just being found out, nobody knew anything about it. And it was actually a terrifying time. I don't know how many of you remember that. There was a young man in my church that God had wonderfully redeemed, wonderfully saved out of a homosexual lifestyle. He'd given his heart to Jesus. He was born again. He was so happy. And he acquired AIDS because of his lifestyle that he had lived before the Lord, before he came to know the Lord. I got a call that he was at Beth Israel Hospital in New York City, flesh and bones, dying. I got in my car and I drove in there. At that time, like I said, nobody knew anything about anything. It didn't matter. I had to see Michael. I went in the room to see Michael, and there he was in the bed, and it was very clear that he was near death. And I was so sad. I was so happy for my brother that he had found the Lord. He found joy in his life. And I leaned over, and I just said, Michael, is there anything I can do for you? And he whispered, and he said, Pastor Brennan, I want to be baptized. He had never been baptized. He didn't have the chance. This disease struck him very quickly after he gave his life to the Lord. But here he is, Beth Israel Hospital. How am I baptizing him? I had to improvise. I knew the Lord would understand. I went over to the sink. I took out of the dispenser a big wad of paper towels, and I saturated them with water. I went over to the bed, and I squeezed them over his head, and I said, Michael, based on your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And as the water was running over him, he shot up in the bed, perfectly erect, his eyes open wide. He stared at the wall in front of him, and he said, Jesus, just like that, closed his eyes. And when he laid down, it was like somebody was laying him down. He just went right down and he died. Those who completely cut their ties to this earth are granted by the Lord a vision of the glory that awaits them. Stephen had cut off all his ties. He knew what his words meant. He knew what they were going to do with him. And it didn't matter because he was only trying to please one. That was his Lord and his Savior, Jesus Christ. He spoke words that were, and I hope I can explain this, but there are times in my life when I've experienced really serious, serious trials that I gathered up my faith and my strength in prayer and in the Word, and I got up and I just faced them in his name and in his power. And when I did, it was like I was singing a song. I don't know if that makes sense, but I can't sing. I've always wanted to sing. I could just imagine just letting your voice belt out of you And in those moments of rising up against whatever the thing would be, I imagine myself just singing a song of faith to the Lord. And I could just picture Stephen's words here like a song. I heard a Brooklyn Tabernacle song recently, and it reminded me of this. Let me read this to you. It's called His Favorite Song of All. It's the Lord's favorite song of all. Listen, His favorite song of all is the song of the redeemed. Nothing more he'd rather hear, nor so pleasing to his ear. He lifts his hands for silence when the weakest, saved by grace, begins to sing. And a million angels listen as a newborn soul sings, I have been redeemed. I could just imagine at this moment, all of heaven is silent as God raises his hands and the Lord Jesus listens as the first martyr since his own death on the cross, the first one to die like he died. Would Stephen say those words? Remember them? Jesus says, Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. Stephen says, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Jesus says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Stephen says, Lord, don't hold this sin against them. He is in perfect alignment, having taken up his cross. He got right behind Jesus and walked up to Calvary and died in exactly the same way. This is what it means to be a disciple of Jesus, to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow him all the way. Stephen was only concerned with pleasing Jesus, even if it meant his own death. And the stones that were pelting him and landing at his feet were piling up as a memorial to the one who pleases God. And over here is Saul. Piling up at his feet are the soft garments of outer cloaks, a memorial to someone who only wanted to please men. Which of those two are you? Completely surrendered to the Lord, on God's fast track, or still trying to please everyone else and yourself? Let's bow our heads, close our eyes. Make a decision today. Who are you going to serve? Make a decision today. Do you want to be on God's fast track, or are you going to continue the way you are? If you have never surrendered your life to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, this is the moment you need to do it. Open your heart. Tell him you're sorry for your sins. I'll lead you in a prayer, but make a decision right now. You're going to do it. You might think you're at home in your living room, in your den, in your office, your bedroom, wherever you are. Nobody sees, nobody knows. You'll just be quiet and let me finish. Don't do that. God's in that room. He's listening. You have felt his finger pointing at you this entire message. Obey and surrender. Say these words after me. Repeat them. Lord Jesus, repeat them. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you went to the cross for me. I thank you that from the cross, you forgave my sins. 3 days later, you rose in power and you have ascended to the right hand of the throne of God. By that power, come into my life and raise me up and make me a brand new person. In your name I pray. Amen. If you said that prayer, there's a place at Zarephath.org's website, Pray Connect. Click on that. Type out what you did. We want to know, okay? Somebody will reach out to you. And then believers, it's time to get serious. It's time to get on God's fast track. Do you know that everywhere else in the Bible, Jesus is seated at the right hand of God? Only here he stands. Do you know why he stood? Stephen really got his attention. Let's really get the Lord's attention by completely surrendering to him. God bless you. Remember next week, the open air event here, July 12th, out on the soccer field. See you then.
Restored forever. God alone has the power to redeem, amen? God alone. And I will thank the Lord then with all my heart as I meet with his godly people. How amazing are the deeds of the Lord. All who delight in him should ponder them. Everything he does reveals his glory and majesty. His righteousness never fails. He causes us to remember his wonderful works. How gracious and merciful is our Lord. He gives food to those who fear him. He always remembers his covenant. He has shown his great power to his people by giving them the lands of other nations. All he does is just and good, and all his commandments are trustworthy. They are forever true, to be obeyed faithfully and with integrity. He has paid a full ransom for his people. He has guaranteed his covenant with them forever. What a holy and awe-inspiring name he has. For the Lord is the foundation and the beginning of wisdom. And all who obey his commandments will grow in wisdom, and we will praise him forever. God, you alone have the power to redeem. Let's Let's go through that one more time. One more time. God, so you alone have made a way. There's nothing we can add to it or take away from it. It's finished. It's done. It's paid in full. You alone have the power to